From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
I'm Anne McLean from the Library's Music Division. It's a great pleasure to welcome you to a new mini-series we're launching this season, Perspectives on Music and Technology. We're presenting this afternoon two musical visionaries, Mark Applebaum and Ge Wang. They are trendsetting and globetrotting thinkers, inventors, and innovators, and practitioners of the ancient profession of the composer-performer. You find that words like metaphysics and alchemy tend to pop up in descriptions of their work. As philosophers, instrument makers, experimentalists, software designers, and sometimes conceptual and performance artists, they command and conjure brilliant metamorphoses of gesture and object that are portals to transformative musical expression. You read daily about the next level technology. These gentlemen are creating it by the hour, discriminating finally, demonstrating their discoveries, and sharing them with a worldwide audience. Creators of complex computer systems and artistic systems, they're ecumenical and perhaps evangelical enthusiasts whose extraordinary body of work encourages and inspires music making by everyone, and you'll find they have large doses of humor and a strong element of play. We're very pleased to be partnering with Stanford University's Arts and Humanities program in making this event possible. It's going to be the beginning of a series of talks like this coming in the next 2 years. Both our speakers are faculty members at Stanford, and I'm going to say that in introducing these folks briefly, I wanted to say we're just giving a very, very brisk overview of their work. For our webcast later on, we'll be attaching their complete biographies, which you have in your program. Dr. Wang is an assistant professor in Stanford's Center for Computer Research and Music and Acoustics, CARMA. Called a sonic pioneer by the New York Times, he researches and creates programming languages and interactive software systems for computer music, mobile, and social music, and education at the intersection of computer science and music. At Stanford, he directs the Slork Laptop Orchestra and the MOFO Consortium. He's also the co-founder of and the chief creative officer of Smool, which you'll hear about shortly, and the designer of the iPhone's groundbreaking Ocarina and Magic Piano apps, among others, some of which you may be using already, along with 25 million or so other people. His talk today is The Leading Edge, Software Design for Musical Expression. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Ge Wang.
Hey everybody, how's it going? I guess I'll just jump right in. Thank you, Anne. It's wonderful to be here. It's an honor to be here at the Library of Congress, and it's an honor to be here with my friend and colleague Mark Applebaum. So we hope to, well, to tell you a little bit about the stuff that we do and what, you know, what this technology thing has to do with music and the arts, at least from our various points of view. And as for me, computer software is my tool, and making musical things with it, I guess that's my craft, or perhaps my art. And I want to tell you today about one way to use technology to maybe change a little bit the way people think about making music. And part of my goal, perhaps, is something that's pictured here, is just to use technology to get people, musicians and people who don't usually think of themselves musicians, to come together and make music. But let me start at the beginning, give you a little bit about my background. I grew up in Beijing with my grandparents, and they got me my first musical instrument when I was 7, that would be the accordion. And all my life, my family has encouraged me to follow my interests, whatever that may be, and music is something that they saw that I gravitated towards early, and they just kept feeding me musical things in a way that's, I think, really natural and very encouraging. And when I moved to the U.S. at the age of 9, I lived with my parents, and for my 13th birthday, out of the blue, my parents got me an electric guitar for my birthday, and this changed my world, and I played a lot of, I began to rock out, as it were, and I also thought in retrospect that this was kind of a bold move on my parents' part, because, by preemptively, they're kind of giving their child this instrument of rebellion, this electric guitar. But in retrospect, that seemed like a pretty good move, because I guess if you preemptively sanction rebellion by doing something like this, you kind of take the fun out of rebelling. And thus, I was generally a pretty good kid and had a lot of good times with my parents. And, I'm very thankful to this day to my parents and my grandparents for just encouraging me to really follow my interests. And that I did when I went to undergrad at Duke, studied computer science there with a lot of music classes. And it was at Duke that I really came to study computer science and use it and see it as a way to build things, to achieve things that I maybe ideas I have in my mind, and then to use computer and software to realize that. At the same time, I pursued my other interest, and that's music. And it wasn't until grad school that I really put them together, but this is thanks to a class I took at Duke. It was, at the time, the only electronic music class available. It's taught by Scott Lindroth, who, by the way, is now Duke's Vice Provost for the Arts. And after this class, I was like, I think maybe there is a way you can put computer and music together. And that I did in grad school. And that's not me in grad school. This is just, this is kind of symbolizing thinking about how music and computers might play together. Computers actually have been attractive to composers, researchers, for quite some time. In fact, as early as the 1800s, Lady Lovelace, some call her the world's very first computer programmer, theorized that, hey, someday we're gonna have computers that allow us to make scientific pieces of music. And it wasn't about 100 years later, about in the 1950s, that computers actually started making sound. Now, for me in grad school, I started putting these two passions of mine together, using computers to build things and making music. And I ended up creating, for my thesis, something called Chuck. It's a music programming language. It's open source, it's freely available. And I always like to think that it will crash equally well on whatever operating system you happen to be running it on. There's actually a MOOC on Chuck that just started last week on Coursera. So if you want to jump right in, along with I think something like 35,000 people who's now in the course, I invite you to do that. And Chuck is kind of another stage in kind of my wanting to build things, to make music. In this case, it wasn't making music, it was making a tool that can help me and maybe hopefully other people make music. But so let me give you a quick demo of Chuck. So it's a programming language, and whether you've written a line of code in your life before or not, I wager you'll be able to follow what I'm about to do. So what I'm gonna create here is a sine osc, it's a sine wave oscillator. I'm gonna call it foo. I'm going to connect it using this thing, which is the Chuck operator, make it a little bigger, to the DAC, which is the abstraction for the sound output on my computer. And I'm gonna say 440, set it to the frequency of foo. Now if I do this, there's a plus sign which says, hey, that's a correct Chuck program, but we hear no sound. And that's because Chuck is what we call a strongly timed language. You need to deal with time to deal with sound. So what I'm gonna do here is to say, send 2 seconds to this special thing called now in Chuck. And if I did things correctly, we should hear that sine wave for 2 seconds. And if you think about it, time and sound, well, they're pretty inextricably related. Without the passage of time, I don't know how its sound or music would be. So in this case, that's how Chuck was modeled. By controlling time, we can control and synthesize sound. So I'm just gonna use this thing, but you copy it 3 times, changes to 220 at 5 seconds, 440, we'll stay there, 0.5 seconds, and then go up, double the frequency again, and going up 1 octave. and we've got the sequence of tones. Next, we're going to add a control structure. And what this is going to do is basically says, hey, we're going to loop the content of everything that's in this while structure. And this is one of the things that make computers really powerful, is the ability to make decision and loop. In this case, we're just going to go. OK, so if I didn't stop that, that would go on for like quite some time, probably until my computer melted. But we're able to construct now this kind of sequence of tones over and over again. But instead, I am now going to generate a random number between 30 and 1,000 and set that as the frequency, foo, and do so every half a second. That seems a little slow, so I'm going to make this every 100 milliseconds. Still one sine wave, and we should get something. Okay, so what we've accomplished here now, still using one sine wave, is what I think of as kind of the canonical computer music. This is kind of the sound that mainframe computers are supposed to be making when they're thinking really hard about something, right? They're supposed to be going like that. So still one sine wave, but let's keep going. What if we change the frequency of foo every 10 milliseconds? That is 100 times a second. Think of that as the computer's version going blah, 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 blah. And then let's do this 1,000 times a second. We're setting the frequency of foo randomly 1,000 times a second. Still one sine wave. And here we cross an interesting perceptual threshold where we stop perceiving the sine wave as individual changes in frequency, but rather now as kind of this carpet of sound. And this is what Chuck allows you to do, is kind of zoom in to time and control the things that's making sound at various granularities. And of course, you can go back up. So that was a millisecond. You know, we saw a second. We have, can do things on the order of minutes. And this would be a rather slowly evolving sine wave. But then it could get even slower. There's an hour. There's a day. There's a week. So in this case, we'd have the sine wave that potentially changes to a new frequency every week. I always thought, well, by the way, Chuck is freely available, so if you want, you can actually download this and, like, I don't know, run it on a computer in your house at, like, the lowest perceivable volume for weeks and see if anyone notices. I always thought that may be a fun thing to do to your loved ones. And so in this same mechanism, we can actually zoom in and zoom out of time to control sound. Now I'll show you another aspect of Chuck, something we called on-the-fly programming. The idea here is that, well, it's kind of a rapid prototyping using programming to create sound. And you can really make changes very rapidly. That is, you can, as the program is running, you can make changes to it. And then you're basically swapping out pieces of the software as it's going. It's kind of like driving a car while you're fixing and updating the engine. So there's some dangers associated with this. In this case, I'm just going to start with this code, which is we have a sine wave here. We're going to make a list of pitch classes that we're going to set into various registers. And then we're going to do so every 200 milliseconds. So those are the four things we're going to roughly do in here. Now, if we start this code, since there's only one thing in the list, and we're not randomizing the musical registers, it's really just hearing this one tone. If we were to randomize the octaves, you can kind of see a skipping in between on the same pitch class. But then we start adding things to it. Every time you see an equal sign, I'm basically replacing an existing version of the software with a new one. So just add it a second, a major third, perfect fifth. At this point, I'm going to make everything a little bit higher and a little bit faster. So a sixth and a seventh. And let's add a little reverberation to it all. And maybe just a little bit more. And a little faster. And drop this. And so in this way, we can experiment both with little passages of sound and of pieces that we might be writing. And also you can use this as a way to experiment with building synthesis models to make sound in a certain way, or how we might map a physical interaction device, such as joystick, up to make sound in software. So that's a little bit of Chuck. Now, it's actually going to pervade everything else I'm going to talk about, so it's giving me an idea, but we're going to come back to our friend Chuck. Now, I went to grad school at Princeton, and you know, this is, as I said, is where I really started trying to put things together between computer science and music. I was very fortunate to be part of the Princeton Laptop Orchestra, and this is kind of a unique ensemble that was started by my advisor Perry Cook and music faculty Dan Truman at Princeton. And I was very fortunate to be part of the team that got to put this together and figure out how to compose for it and how to teach this as a course, which we did. And this used Chuck as one of the main teaching tools, as well as one of the main tools for building musical instruments. The idea here is that we want to combine elements of traditional ensemble, say like a chamber orchestra, with the possibilities of computers for making sound, new interactions. And in some ways, adding a lot of technology, but hopefully not losing the human element in all of this. And when I started at Stanford on the faculty in 2007, I brought the idea over with me to the West Coast and started the Stanford Laptop Orchestra. The Princeton one is Plork, the Stanford one is Slork. And the idea of both orchestras is that one is we use special hemispherical speaker arrays paired with each laptop. The idea is that, well, if you play an acoustic instrument such as violin, the sound does not naturally go through like a PA system and come inward at you. It comes from the artifact itself. And so in this case, by creating these arrays, we are in some ways emulating point sources that are our instruments, which come from the laptop. And so we're creating a sort of this intimate electronic chamber music, if you will, using the laptop orchestra. I'll briefly just give you a sense how we built these things. The speaker arrays were built from IKEA salad bowls. These were 11-inch Blanda mat. I think you can still get these at IKEA. First step, you turn it upside down. You drill a lot of holes in them, 6 holes per enclosure, because that's how many speaker drivers are going to put in each one. When you take a bass plate, which we cut out of these big wooden boards we got from Ace Hardware, we're going to sand them, we're going to route them, and then basically we're going to attach them to the bottom of the enclosure. We're going to put amplifiers inside. That's going to drive 6 independent channels of sound. And we're going to have to do this quite a few times because we end up building 20 speaker systems. Fortunately, we have very wonderful, energetic, creative people, in this case, students, and at Karma's old Max Lab, where we basically prototype physical interaction design and build stuff. In this case, we build the speakers, and when we're done, it looks something like this. It looks like kind of the top of R2-D2 from Star Wars. And before you know it, we had a laptop orchestra that we're performing and creating pieces for, and it's a course now both at Stanford, and it's been a course at Princeton as well. So to give you a sense what the laptop orchestra kind of looks and sounds like, here's some excerpts. In the last 5 years, there have been over 100 different instruments and pieces that's premiered for the laptop orchestra, most of them by students who are in the ensemble and course. In this case, we're using sensors to track the location of the player's hands in real time. And in the next piece, Michael is going to be using a Wiimote to play a piece which has to do with chanting, monks chanting, the Wiimote, and basically imitation, resulting in like this horrible pun of a name, Monk We See, Monk We Do. This is a piece called Barrel, it's because it's actually a multi-person auto harp using various sensors, duct tape literally to the side of a metal barrel. The conductor actually stands on top of the barrel and creating both a sonic and as well as a visual experience for the players and the audience. This piece is called Converge. It's by my grad student Juno and myself. We collected hundreds of images and sounds and geotagged, time-tagged through mobile phones. And we're kind of bringing all these things together in this visual sonic blender to kind of as a meandering in the moments of everyday life. Kind of almost celebrating a little bit of the mundane and just thinking about memory and location and time. Now, these are three more instruments built with the game track controller. So this is Charlie's actually plucking a bass. So by changing the length of the tether, that's of course changing the pitch of the instrument, he can pluck it, can actually bow it. Nick is playing an invisible harp. Adam has air drums. And finally, we have the experimental headbang orchestra. In this case, we tie the sensors to our heads, which detect the headbanging. And it's sensitive to motion such as shaking of the head. And if you tilt your head, it's like a whammy effect. So those are just a few of the more than 100 pieces that have now premiered for the laptop orchestra. And I'm actually just gonna give you a quick demo before I move on of two of the instruments we built. First, I'm gonna kill all instances of Chuck running on my computer. And there we go. Switch over to joystick. Okay, so this is a software written in Chuck. It's a little singing synthesizer. Nothing we're about to hear is actually recorded. It's all being generated on the fly in software using various signal generators and filters. And we're trying to create this sing voice we can control with this basic joystick here. So when I squeeze the trigger, it starts singing. Now, this is not going to fool anyone. It's a fairly synthetic voice. But realism here isn't really, you know, the only goal. If you were to move it to different corners, you get different vowels. And if you do so smoothly, interpolate, and it's kind of like gently putting your hands inside someone's vocal cavity and gently shaping it to create different vowels. If you twist, you get vibrato. This is volume. And then, since it's a model, you can make it sing, but you can also replace the sound, the source of the sound, but while keeping the vowel structure, you can make it breathe. And then we can map keys on the keyboard to make this sing different pitches. So I just press the keys ZCBADGWE. I think we can sing kind of low. And pretty high. And So, you know, that's an instrument where I think you can actually, without achieving a great degree of realism, actually achieve some degree of expressiveness. And to us in actually building these instruments, oftentimes expressiveness trumps realism in that, well, if something's expressive, we can make expressive use of it. That's the beginning of an instrument with which you can create music. I'm going to show you a different instrument. This one is called, from a piece called Twilight. The first one is called Joy of Chant. And let me see if I can get this guy going. This is a game track controller. It's actually originally created to be like a golfing controller. It has two gloves that's actually on tethers. And this is what tracks the location of my hands in real time. Now, this ended up being not the most successful gaming controller, but computer music researcher caught wind of this and said, oh, wow, this is like a great thing to prototype new instruments. And now, it's, because they're trying to get rid of all this inventory, it's like super cheap. So we actually have, we actually bought 100 of these at Stanford to actually prototype instruments. And the people we bought it from actually sent us 200 without telling us. I think they're trying to just get rid of what inventory they had. But I'm gonna show you one instrument that's mapped with this. Now this instrument, I wanted to create something that was like you're pulling a sound out of the ground. So let me see if this works. And if you move left or right, the pitch is actually mapped to be detuned. And let's choose a slightly less abrasive sound. Can we create a drone? And then finally, I want to create kind of this virtual giant drum that you can kind of bang. Imagine there's like a surface here. Wow, it's like louder than I... So this is just one of many instruments in the laptop orchestra. Now, the more instruments we end up making, the more we kind of come back to this very basic question, you know, what is an instrument? And I think everyone may have a somewhat different answer to this. And for us, the more we do this, the more we feel like we don't really know, and there's just a really rich answer to this. For example, if you were to put in my hands a 1715 Stradivarius violin, I would say, well, this is a really exquisite, expensive wooden box. I don't play the violin, so to me, that's kind of all it is. You put it in the hands of someone who actually knows how to play violin, I think then it begins to become a real instrument. At the same time, you know, people make music with whatever they can find. In this case, just some plastic barrels and some sticks and a flute. So the thought is that really, not anything is automatically an instrument, and a lot of things, well, there may ostensibly not be an instrument, but perhaps if we just have the will to make music with it, it can become an instrument. And it's with all these thoughts in mind that, and also like in a bout of insanity, I co-founded a company called Smule in 2008. In some ways to bring the stuff that we've been doing in our academic research and in tandem with academic research that's continuing, ongoing, to bring all of this to a different type of audience and perhaps a wider audience so we can in some ways see the effects, but also bring just this joy of music making to a lot of people who otherwise might not. And the way we did it was we started with mobile phones. We started creating apps for the iPhone right when the App Store was launched in the summer of 2008. And one of the first things we created was Ocarina, and it's a flute-like instrument for your iPhone. Let's give you a demo of this. So Ocarina is it's supposed to be like a fairly simple flute-like instrument for your iPhone, and where we arrived at this was really thinking about, well, it wasn't like we wanted to have an instrument, and then we said, oh, let's go figure out how to do this on the phone. We kind of looked at the phone and said, okay, what can we build with this that embraces its capabilities and limitations? And it seemed like an ocarina, which is a fairly simple instrument to learn comparatively, it seemed to fit the profile. I'm literally blowing into the microphone located at the bottom of the iPhone. There's a Chuck script that's running inside that's tracking the amplitude of my breath. At the same time, multi-touch is used to map to the finger holes so I can provide pitch. An accelerometer is mapped to vibrato. And you can play a lot of little ditties with this. So on and so forth, and well, thank you very much. Later we started adding game-like features in this to kind of teach people how to play things by providing little on-screen guides for which you might want to play next, while leaving you with some degree of expressiveness. So in this case, it waits for you because we didn't want to hurry people, and they can kind of choose their own tempo and adornments if they want to this. So in this case, it's kind of just hanging out here until I play the next note. Note, I'm kind of tilting this phone in different ways just to add and remove vibrato. For example, and then finally there's some things you can do with this that you can't easily do with traditional ocarinas. For example, here's the whistle mode. So that's the interaction, the interface to Ocarina, and it was really designed to, as I said, to try to take advantage of everything that is or isn't the iPhone. We wanted a four-hole English pendant ocarina, so five-point multi-touch on the iPhone. Well, that really worked out. It's a phone, so it has a microphone that we can blow into. It has all these sensors, and now includes a compass and a gyroscope, but back then it was just the accelerometer. But then you also had GPS, and also the fact that this thing is always constantly connected to the internet. And these are the things we really want to take advantage of. So as part of the instrument interaction itself, that's half of it, the more gestural, physical interaction side of it. And another part is actually the social interaction, which I'll show you in just a minute. But first, I'll show you a video we made to promote this. That's Jeff Smith is my co-founder. It's Tina, Chrissy. Rob, this is Turner the Mule. He's our field marketing specialist. After seeing this video, people have referred to as kind of, you know, that band of dirty iPhone hippies or something like that. So I think probably being on a carpet and having a crystal ball that glows in the middle probably helps that imagery. So now we know. And then after we released Ocarina, people, you know, to our pleasant surprise, really started using it a lot. To date, there are more than 10 million users of Ocarina. When it was launched, people didn't just use it, they kind of took to the internet and created videos of them performing for the world. Here's one such user. Yeah, so she's actually playing this with her nose. And apparently she's been a lifelong nose flautist. And the iPhone is just kind of her latest nose flute. So she was actually a winner in our Ocarina this Video Contest Blows video contest. And like all other winners, we sent her prize money, a t-shirt, and for her, we also sent her a box of Kleenex for her trouble. Now, I mentioned there's another piece to Ocarina, and part of it comes from this thought that, well, the more we work with technology, the more we feel kind of this desire to try to put it in some context, to think about what the role of technology could be, especially as it relates to music. And there are many different answers to this because there are so many different technologies, and some ramifications just can't be observed readily. We kind of think back to this idea from Mark Weiser, who's one of the fathers of ubiquitous computing, who's the CTO of Xerox PARC 20 years ago. In some ways, he kind of envisioned kind of this mobile revolution that we're going through right now, where there are all these personal computers roaming about in the physical world. And he thought that, well, technology should create calm. In some sense, it maybe doesn't have to be in our face all the time in order to be useful or interesting. And it's kind of with thoughts like this in mind that we created the globe in Ocarina, which is kind of a listener to the rest of the world playing this instrument. And if I were to tune in to the globe right now, assuming I can get internet here. This is someone calling themselves Xiaoming from Beijing, it looks like. South America. And you can kind of keep skipping through the world. Here's someone calling themselves PBJ. Must like sandwiches a lot. And today, people have listened to each other some 50 million times on the globe. And it's one of those things where we just try to build something where it gives you a sense that there is someone somewhere out there that's maybe also blowing into their iPhone, but also playing music. If you hear Final Countdown being played from somewhere in Korea, you know, I think it kind of begs the question, it's like, you know, who is that? Why are they playing Final Countdown? Is that like a popular song there, or is that someone who likes the song who's traveling there? And these questions don't really have answers, but nonetheless, they're interesting questions to ask. Furthermore, I wanted to create something where, you know, when people first look at this, they get a sense of not technology, but maybe just a little bit of humanity. They feel, oh, here's the world. There's someone on the other side of it. And you know, the first thought shouldn't be that this is cool technology. It should be that there's actually a different kind of connection that you can kind of build using this, however small that may be. And so one day we're looking at, you know, reviews of Ocarina in the iTunes Store, and we came across this one. This one said, "This is my piece on Earth. I'm currently deployed in Iraq, and hell on Earth is an everyday occurrence. The few nights I may have off, I'm deeply engaged in this app. The globe feature that lets you hear everybody else in the world playing is the most calming art I've ever been introduced to. It brings the entire world together without politics or war. It's the exact opposite of my life, deployed U.S. soldier." So when we read this, we were like, wow, you know, this kind of, if we were able even just to reach one person with this, then it's in some sense really worth it. And I guess we're very humbled when we saw this. And all of this, you know, really reminds me back to another quote by Mark Weiser when he wrote a really famous paper called Computer for the 21st Century. And he started this paper by saying, "The most profound technologies are those that disappear. They weave themselves into the fabric of everyday life until it's indistinguishable from it." And if we think about the technology we're using and we're making use of, for example, super smartphones that are very mobile and very personal, then there's some aspect to it that is disarming. There's some aspect that is fundamentally different in terms of how we can relate people's everyday life behavior to technologies that can either encourage or dissuade them from certain ways of going about our lives. And by the way, I actually created an app for specifically moments of daily life called MadPad. So MadPad is really, you know, it's an improvised instrument that you can really cobble together from just, you know, sounds and imagery from your surroundings, from your daily life. And you can actually share this with other people nearby or just, you know, anyone else who's using the app. And we've seen definitely a lot of all kinds of unconventional uses for that, and it's pretty great. The other way to think about technology is kind of the side effect of technology, especially in how we make music or how we don't make music. And, you know, apparently 100 years ago, you know, families made music as part of their daily entertainment. There's no television, there's no radio, there's no computer. To have music, you kind of had to make it or be somewhere where it's made. And, you know, music seems one of these things that's so fundamentally human. You know, there's never been a culture in recorded history that's been without music or dance. And so it's something that we want. But now as this technology began to surface, these wondrous technology, radio, recording, they're amazing. At the same time, it's had the side effect of, I think, making it easier to get to music, but in a way that's perhaps more passive. And as recording came about, we kind of started going to this situation where there's kind of this few-to-many relationship, very few producers compared to the very many consumers who passively take in music. Now, listening to music is awesome, but there's a different type of joy that you get with making it that I think people tend to be missing more and more. So perhaps with the latest technology that is disarming because the phone, for example, travels with us where we go, and also because the phone ostensibly is not a musical instrument, but we can make it into something that's musical and expressive. Perhaps we can get people to rediscover that joy of music making. And it's been kind of the research, and as we create instruments for the Stanford Mobile Phone Orchestra, and we have all these horrible five-letter names for everything. You know, there's like Chuck, there's Karma, there's Plork, there's Slork, and there's Mofo with a PH, Mobile Phone Orchestra, and where we were speakers on gloves to amplify our phones, but also to stay mobile. But also we build games. Games with an expressive side, as I like to think of it. There's Magic Fiddle, it's pictured to the right, and there's Magic Piano. And it looks something like this. Is actually in the foothills behind Stanford. Yeah, I kind of want people just to run, frolic through the wild wilderness playing their iPhone. So, enough of that. Let me give you a quick demo of Magic Piano. It looks something like that. Zoom in. So there are these dots that fall from the top. The score is kind of baked in, but it's kind of up to you to express them. And there are quite a few ways you can do this. So you can do something like that, or you can, for example, just swing it a bit. Let's see if we can get this. And as usual, this, you know, also waits for you. You can play this at whatever speed you want. And that's Magic Piano. And today there's some 30 million users of Magic Piano just banging away, and they've collectively played like over like a billion notes in this app, for a rather crude metric of how much people are playing this. And then there's auto rap, which is a kind of a different way to be expressive.
I am the Almighty Bamboo.
Thanks. So how many people saw Mark crawling across the back? Yeah, he was actually, that wasn't planned. He was actually trying to avoid the camera, which he thought he could do by crawling across, but no. And then there's, finally, there's T-Pain, which is yet another way of thinking about technology as a way to kind of give people some freedom to be out there without so much inhibition, but at the same time retaining a little bit of themselves. And that's using auto-tune, of all things. And it kind of has, you know, say what you will about auto-tune, but it has this effect of kind of like alcohol, perhaps, loosening people up just a bit. Maybe that's why T-Pain sings so many songs about drinking. Anyway, here's a song about drinking. I'm just singing that for you. After the piano video, I felt like I just didn't really have much inhibition anymore about anything. So I'm just going to embarrass myself one more time. Yeah, y'all are very kind. Now, if you think back to the first picture I had of people going onto the street to make music, well, this is what people are doing once again with this. And if, I guess because it's a mobile phone, they can do that. And these people, again, making more videos of themselves singing with T-Pain. In this case, you know, there's songs called "I'm on a Train," "I'm on a Phone," "I've Got Cotton," "I'm Going to School," and it's just people in everyday life expressing themselves. And in some way, you know, that's one of the richness of music that I feel like we can really bring back with technology. It's not necessarily to make everyone into like an overnight rock star, but to let technology be a way for people to start rediscovering that joy of music so that it can be something that, for the very least, they can enrich their everyday lives. And I think that's something that's worth doing. And I'm going to end with just one thought. One thought and an example. The thought is that, well, the way the computing and as it relates to people is changing. The old computing, you might say, is about what computers can do, whereas the new computing is about what people can do. And as we design with technology, we can't really get away from technology. It's central to what we do, but it's always good to continue to ask the question, you know, what can we do with people? Because I think that's the bigger question. In the wake of the 2011 earthquake and tsunami disaster in Japan, a woman in Tokyo started a rendition of "Lean on Me" in our app Glee Karaoke, and she said, "Hey, everybody, join me in song," and people did. In a few weeks, something like 5,000 people joined in on this from all over the world, presumably all strangers, and they did hear that. Well, again, it's not technology is foregrounded, but that, you know, you actually don't need an explanation of thinking about why, oh, singing together with a lot of strangers for this, in answer to this woman's asking to sing together, is why that's interesting or meaningful. And this is what it sounds like when it's about 100 or 1,000 people. So in conclusion, I just want to say, for me, there's kind of two purposes that perhaps technology can serve in terms of software and what I want to do with it for music. One is kind of going back to the past, getting people to rediscover the joy of not only listening to music, but making music, and helping people to lose a little bit of inhibition, because I think there is an artist and musician that is in every single person, and I think all we need isn't, we don't need to make people into artists, we just need to chip away at the inhibition that keeps the musician from expressing himself or herself. The other piece of this is to think about what new instruments might be possible. Can we get, for example, a million strangers to make music together? What would such an instrument feel like? How would it play? What would be the type of music we can make in such a situation? And what would it feel like to make music meaningfully as part of, you know, a million people or more? So I think those are questions still to be answered, and I want to thank you very much for listening.
So next we're going to have a talk and a performance by Dr. Mark Applebaum. Again, both our speakers are from Stanford University. Mark Applebaum is Associate Professor of Composition there, recently named the Hazy Family University Fellow in Undergraduate Education and the Leland and Edith Smith Faculty Scholar. He directs SIC, the Stanford Improvisation Collective, and is also a terrific jazz pianist who tours a lot. A long roster of his compositions, including orchestral, operatic, chamber, and electroacoustic works, and many, many intermedia collaborations, including sound sculptures and installations of some fascinating types, which you'll learn about, have been performed worldwide. Some of you may be already familiar with his amazing inventions, devices like the mouse trap and the mouseketeer. Again, we thank Stanford University so much. We thank these guys, and please welcome Mark Applebaum.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Anne, for that warm introduction, and thank you all for being here. I'm delighted to be here with my colleague, Ge Wang. I realize now that I really wish I went first, but in any case, I find myself here now, and I am very much delighted to share with you some of my music and my musical thought. I've selected a number of pieces to share with you that have two, I think, important or at least relevant aspects. One is that they all involve music technology in various ways, and that music technology is comparatively, we would say, low-tech rather than high-tech, and hence the idea of the rehabilitation of archaic technologies in the title of my portion. And then the other thing is that my recent work has decidedly turned towards visual paradigms. So, this is to say, something that is now being called visual music, music in which what you see is as important as what you hear, and in a few cases that I'll share with you today, what you see is maybe more important than what you hear. And in this presentation, I'm going to share a number of pieces, excerpts of pieces, and I will perform one piece in its entirety, a piece called Aphasia, which is for hand gestures synchronized to sound, and that will be sort of in the middle of the presentation. I'd like to start here with these devices. These are all hammers, but they're kind of weird hammers, and they remind me of the adage that Maslow's law, which says basically, to a man with only a hammer, all the world looks like a nail. And I think this is the danger of having only one tool, and hence the reason why I'd like to have a lot of different tools. I want to return to this at the very end, but I want to place this in your mind now. I've divided this talk into a few sections. The first is about instruments, and you've seen some extraordinary instruments earlier today, and I'd like to share with you some of my instruments, things I call sound sculptures, and I've been building these instruments since 1990, and they are indeed instruments that have hopefully a stunning array of sound possibilities that expand the timbral palette that is available, but also they're deliberately made and they're intended to have like arresting visual properties. They're supposed to be kind of cool to look at. They are instruments starting with the mousetrap, a kind of tabletop size instrument that I built in 1990. It's made of junk and hardware and found objects mounted on electroacoustic soundboards. And these are played with chopsticks and wind-up toys, plectra, violin, bows, wind-up toys, and so forth. And it's, and again, this is low tech. This is stuff from the junkyard and the hardware store and so on. The Minnie Mouse was a small instrument designed to sit on the music desk of the grand piano so I could have old instruments and new together available under my fingertips. The duplex mouse phone was another one. The MIDI mouse, I want to call your attention actually in the MIDI mouse to the 5-pin DIN jack, the MIDI jack, which is on the right corner of the MIDI mouse. It's not wired to anything on the back side. And this is just, I don't know, kind of just like a personal jab at the optimism of contemporary music technology. Again, by the way, when the power goes out at the Electroacoustic Music Festival, I'm the only one who can still play because this stuff just makes, it just makes noise anyway. This is when I was living in Copenhagen. I was bending bronze brazing rod into weird shapes, and these things just sound really great when you amplify them. So I do like having electricity. By the way, I'm not against electricity. I need to make that very clear. Electricity has enriched my life to a shocking extent. This is a bird's eye view of the mousetrap surface. You can see on the right the red 100 yen store Hello Kitty chopsticks that I purchased in Tokyo. All sorts of different things. People at the Darmstadt Festival in Germany a little bit confused. And then here's the Mouseketeer, which is the most recent instrument. There's one view of it, a side view, and then kind of a close-up. Now, what it looks like in concert is actually something slightly different, and that's this slide. And what you'll notice is that the Mouseketeer is at the right, but there's other stuff, all right? So let me explain a little bit. So if we look at this area, this is the parts that you've seen close-ups of. Okay, what is this? This is threaded rods, doorstops, springs, steel wheels, astroturf, corrugated copper tubing, nails, stretched wires, combs, toilet tank floats, bronze brazing rod, PVC pipe, sheet metal, ratchets, metal bells, turnbuckles, shoe horns, car and bicycle parts, and of course, mousetraps. Now, this is all low-tech stuff that you can find. In fact, among these, you could say we could find the lever, the pulley, and the screw, which are in fact medieval technologies. And so let's ascribe some dates here to this circle in the right. Let's use our period of the medieval music period of, or as musicians like to date it, 450 to 1450. So I'll put some dates there. Now this part over here are a bunch of digital signal processors, outboard gear. They're essentially computers. They have microprocessors in them and so forth. So let's put some numbers for this part. I'll choose the numbers 0 and 1 to represent that side. Now, so there's a couple takeaways here from this picture. One is if you were expecting to see like this big, you know, epic fight between like the new technology guy who went first and then the old archaic technology guy, you're going to be slightly disappointed because what you'll notice here is that there is this combination, this hybridization, which is really something that's important to me. I'm interested in the accretion of available tools, not sort of replacing old ones with new ones or in some sort of like, you know, polemical Luddite sort of fashion, smashing the new ones in favor of the more familiar and traditional ones. But another thing that you're going to notice here about this is actually a kind of, I want to dim that view of the hybridization a little bit by noticing a couple things. Number one, it's fraudulent to say 450 to 1450, of course, because the doorstop that I have, while it was that spring was available in the medieval period, was presumably created within the last decade or so. Okay, so it is not technically from the Middle Ages. And similarly, what's important to recognize, and some of you who are very well versed and interested in contemporary trends in music technology already will observe this, and others need to hear me say this and explain it, but all of that high-tech gear on the left side under the 0 and the 1, that's actually people would call that obsolete. It is 3 to 13 years old, that stuff there. It is not cutting edge. So in that regard, it's a question, I suppose, of your like magnification into the past, and you know how far back you're looking. But in some respects, I'm using archaic technology, which is high tech in on one sense because it is computer technology, but it's archaic in that it is not the leading edge of computer technology. So that's something that I wanted to point out. Let's look at a close-up of this instrument. So the Mouseketeer, if I have an arrow towards a nail that's simply pounded into the soundboard, and I want to press this icon so you can hear it. Okay, that's the sound of me plucking that nail. Let's hear it again. But if I put it through a bunch of signal processors, I can make a wide variety of sounds. Here's just two options. Here's one. So that was the same nail pluck. Here's another sound. That was from one articulation. Like my hand looked like this, and then you heard all that other stuff. So you can really deform these things significantly. Here's the sound of bowing with a violin bow, that same nail. With some special bonus 60 cycle hum, I guess. And here's with the processed version of the bowed nail. So my life is enriched, and perhaps in this room, my life alone, has been enriched by the ability to bow and hear a bowed nail. And then it's been further enriched by being able to deform and mutate and transform that bowed nail with all of the computer technology. Let's strum those nails, let's stroke them, and it sounds like this. Okay, I'm clicking. Let's try this one. This is the, I'll see if this one works. I'm not getting anything, we'll go back. Computer is punishing me. Okay, and now the transformed version of that. That's being stroked by a chopstick. And the transformed version. It's a Japanese chopstick, by the way. The Chinese ones covered with surgical tubing have a different kind of property. So, and there's also a weighting thing. It's really an ergonomic, you know, it's like French or German double bass bow grip. These are the kinds of things that Mouseketeer players talk about. Incidentally, I should say that I'm the world's greatest Mouseketeer player, but I'm also, that's the second most important thing you know. The first most important thing is that I'm the world's worst Mouseketeer player. So when you're in a culture of one and you invent a unique instrument and there aren't other players, I think the important thing is to recognize that you are a beginner and ask questions about what it means to evolve that state of the art to an intermediate and an advanced state. Anyway, that's just a bonus concept for you. All right, so let's move. If we turn these squeaky wheels, it sounds like this. First the large one and then the small one. And now a processed version of that. So in a concert performance, whether it's a solo performance or if I'm playing with other traditional or untraditional instrumentalists or vocalists, I have available to me both the unprocessed and the processed sounds, and I can combine them in various ways in alternation. Finally, the combs, and by the way, all the combs that I own are permanently affixed to my sound sculptures. These combs, if you drag your thumbs across the teeth, you would hear, from the center outwards, you'd hear this. And let's hear a processed version. And lastly, what if we put all of those four things that I've taken you through together into a sort of a musical phrase? Let's hear that. So that was a pluck, and then stroking the nails, two wheels, and then the combs. And now let's hear a processed version of that same gesture. All right, I'd like to move on, staying with this idea of instrumentation, but instead of thinking of low-tech instruments, I'd like to think about quotidian ones, prosaic ones, in this piece called Echolalia. The setup looks like this, and let's just watch a little bit of a performance of Brian McWhorter. We'll see the beginning of this piece, which is strictly notated. Okay, so this piece is very much about the sounds of everyday objects, but it's clearly about the theater as well, and it, I think, needs to be seen. Another piece that needs to be seen would be this piece. So this now moves away from prosaic instrumentation to essentially no instruments. This is a piece for three conductors and no players. It was based on the experience I had of watching two people having a virulent argument in sign language, which produced very few decibels to speak of, but was affectively a very loud kind of emotional experience psychologically. So, and we think as musicians about like polyrhythms, like here is the sound of five against three. So I've got five going with my right hand while I have three in my left hand. That's a certain kind of musical pattern. But what does it look like in a conducting space? So here's five, and I have three. So how is this, or is this not, the same as that kind of thing? Here's just a little clip from that piece. And continuing with my penchant for strange instrumentation, or first let me tell you about this piece, which I think actually extends from Tillen. This is a piece for octet, who make very little sound. They actually have three locations, each player represented by green, yellow, and red pictographs here. And then you have also in the score, the conductor is tracking them. Everyone has a primary, tertiary, secondary, and tertiary location represented by a square, a double square, that would be an 8-pointed star, and a triple square, a 12-pointed star. And the conductor sees that at the bottom of the page. And what you find is that, and I'm going to just move out of my presentation here for a second, and see if we can just watch a little bit of the premiere performance of Rabbit Hole by the San Francisco Contemporary Music Players, if my computer will. And let's watch, see a bit of this. I'm getting the spinning rainbow Kaiser wheel of death, Kaiser roll wheel. Okay, here we go. Let's watch just the opening, and you'll see what I'm interested in here. It's really about the choreography, I suppose. Are we getting anything? Well, I'll tell you about it in case we don't see it. The players are moving from space to space, and at very particular times, here we go, they have to pick up particular instruments like the percussionists or mallets and get ready to make an articulation, but the instruments are not actually played or rarely played. Similarly, the string players are asked at various times to be in a state of high alert for a down bow, an up bow, or a pizzicato, or to put on mutes. The trumpet player is asked to put on mutes. All of the ancillary aspects of musical production are used as musical vocabulary and organized in time. That's what composers do. We organize things in time. Usually those things are sounds, but let's not let the sounds get in the way of the music. That's my sort of my new mantra. Moving back here to another unusual kind of instrumentation would be my concerto for florist. where the instrumentalists are playing and making lots of sound. The florist, James Del Prince, whose idea of floristry includes conventionally beautiful flowers as well as like barbed wire and police crime scene tape and all sorts of parts from he salvaged from junkyards and auto graveyards and so forth. He's creating in time, much in the way of the classic Merce Cunningham, John Cage collaborations. The floristry and the music are cohabiting. They're not coordinating. Flashlights inserted into the flowers. And here's an example of the same piece for orchestra. So the orchestra is playing. This is a determinate score. The orchestra is not improvising, but at the same time of their duration, it's a three-movement piece, James is doing his floral thing. And so in this regard, I suppose you would say that florist is an unusual instrumentation. Okay, let's move on to conventional instruments. But we really, if we say that instruments are a kind of technology, if instruments are tools, we might be interested in how they might be used in untraditional ways, in less conventional manners, and in new ways. In that regard, they can be rehabilitated and thought of themselves as a new technology. So composers are always interested in extended techniques, using traditional instruments in extended ways. Here is an example from a piece I composed called Magnetic North. It's for brass quintet. This is a performance by the Meridian Arts Ensemble. And here's just a little passage for trumpet, two trumpets, where they're actually using the trumpets in some slightly unusual manners, or at least not the most traditional trumpet tone. And this is what it sounds like. And here's another passage. You'll hear this enormous, grotesque shake and flutter tongue at the end. So that's a way of taking traditional instruments but giving them a little bit of an edge. This could be heard also in bowed strings. This is a string quartet called 20. I want to play three examples from this piece. In this passage, it's a 20 movement, 20 short movements. In this, this is the movement number 8. The lower two strings, the cello and the viola, are playing very conventional kinds of bowings, conventional sorts of sounds. The upper two strings, the first and second violins, go through sort of four passages. You'll hear how their timbre changes. First, they're playing trills, which is quite conventional, but they're playing them on the bridge, sol ponte cello, to give this very high harmonic, ghostly, glassy kind of sound. Then after that, they play what we call collegno battuto gettato, so striking the strings with the bow of the with the wood of the bow as well as the hair, kind of on its side, and letting the bow rebound off the strings to create kind of quick successive attacks. So that's a more percussive sound than you were traditionally used to. And then we have pizzicato, which is of course very traditional, plucking those strings. But if we had to choose one default kind of comportment in bowed string instruments, that wouldn't be it. So we could at least acknowledge that even if it's traditional, it's not the main mode of musical production, I think, on the violin. And then lastly, we have glissandi, which is a traditional kind of bowing, but the fingers are moving to sort of create these slurpy changes from one pitch to another. Let's hear this passage. Okay, that was like my moment where I was like thinking there could be some people here who like traditional music and they feel comfortable string quartets. So I thought I'd play that. But then I realized like that's not the string quartet that you like and that you want to hear anyway. So that sort of failed. Anyway, I'm going to press ahead. Here you'll hear some more snapping sounds, the sort of snap pizzicato. And here is a, what we call overpressure, or really a kind of a very abrasive, scrunching kind of sound. These are my colleagues at Stanford, the St. Lawrence String Quartet, who are fantastic players of both traditional and contemporary music. The last example from this piece is in the 12th movement, in which the players actually have picked up wrist shakers, various kind of jangly sorts of things that they put on their bowing arm. And so when they move, they get a sympathetic, they care, I guess, a sympathetic sort of shake from these different jangles. And you can hear what that sounds like as a kind of add-on. Okay, so that's a little bit of just thinking about traditional instruments and how we can change their sounds and update them in some ways. Another piece that I want to mention is this one, aphasia. And another way we can use traditional instruments, so the sounds of this piece is the voice, which is our must be our most fundamental and first instrument. But using the computer, we can take that and we can transform the sounds, in this case, in some extreme ways, sometimes grotesquely. We can manipulate recordings of the human voice. So the sounds that you're going to hear, well, let's listen to a little bit of the soundtrack for aphasia. That's actually all derived from voice. Everything you hear is the human voice. I've just used the computer in wild ways to sort of transform it. So I think this project is at once very traditional and yet decidedly modern. Okay, great. And at this point, I think it'd be nice to maybe darken the screen, and then we're going to move forward to a performance of aphasia for hand gestures and tape. And I'll go over here and light. Thank you. If we can light the stage. So this is a what you're going to hear is the soundtrack that you've heard this, the opening already, and I'm going to attempt to execute a series of hand gestures in synchrony with the tape. And I think in the context of the idea that I'm the low-tech guy, you'll notice that I'm not using any of those special gesture tracking laser kinds of things. So this is, in today's day and age, this is a decidedly old-fashioned approach to performing this. And I want to say thanks to Jenny Bilfield, who made this piece possible. She commissioned it as part of the Stanford Lively Arts series a few years ago. So please enjoy.
Bip, 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 bip One,
Thank you very much. And at this point, I think I'd like to show you the score on the screen. It consists of it. So it, first of all, it is a, you know, it's a low-tech sort of thing in the sense that it uses human voice and only human voice samples. And secondly, you know, there wasn't any fancy tracking software. You have to do it the old-fashioned way. You just have to learn. You have to memorize this thing, and then you have to execute it at the right time. It's like there's a lot of music production that's been done that way over many centuries. The score consists of a lengthy, you know, verbose, extraordinarily loquacious a gesture appendix where every one of these gestures is explained in gory detail, and it's named with a. Just so you, in case you're interested, I'll just mention a few details about this piece. It's named with a. There's a pictographic icon that appears in the score, but more important, there's a kind of name that to remember things. So, for example, this gesture is centurion greeting, and this one is key turn, okay? And this is paper from rock, paper, scissors, okay? So now this one, for example, is called smelling salts. It's not important that. The piece is not referring to medical practitioners. Okay, that's not what the piece is about. The piece is about this gesture. But for me to explain to the performer so that he or she can remember it, I call it smelling salts. Similarly, this, some people, when they see it, they think milking cow, but I call that blood pressure from that like thing in the doctor's office where they pumped up the blood pressure, okay? Whereas this one is called peace, and I think a lot of people are gonna see peace. So the point is there's a continuum of cultural iconicity and reference in there, but I'm really interested in the way that these are described, which is to say like the arms do X or Y or Z in this transverse sagittal or, you know, or vertical plane, horizontal planes and so forth. The score that I had to memorize looks like this. There's the The tape part, which you heard, the audio is actually stereo, but I can condensed it into a mono. I sort of summed it, so you can just sort of see the amplitudes of the waveforms, and then I superimpose tempo and meters on that, and then there's a left hand, both hands in the middle, and then right hand on top, showing the various hand gestures in coordination with the sound. Moving on to sort of my last section, which is about thinking about notational technology, that is to say, the score. Some of the scores, all of my scores, or almost all of my scores, with one notable exception, are done by hand. And so, I've over many years worked on my musical orthography, and this is a piece for piano, here's a piece for solo guitar. So this is a traditional application of the score, in that I have an imagined sound in my head, and I've created some sort of notational specification from which a performer can then recreate that sound in performance. That's kind of how we know what a score is in the role of a composer in many respects. I put this here to remind myself to say, because we talked about medieval technologies, so the score, in some respects, is, or even the photocopier, comes from the printing press. So in some ways, we could say that the score is has some, at least the duplication of the score has something to do with a Renaissance kind of orientation, maybe. I'll throw that out there. If we say that technologies are both material and immaterial, so you have the computer is a material technology, but I think we would all agree that computer software is a kind of technology as well, and that's a kind of immaterial technology, then I think we have to say that the score itself is a kind of technology. It is a code of sorts that instructs the realization of something, maybe. That could be seen in this piece of mine for chamber orchestra called 56 and a half feet, which begins rather conventionally, but by and by, various indeterminacies creep in, like this measure here. Can you see my cursor here? So this measure is a musical mobile where every player chooses to start, has three different materials, and they start in any of those points and proceed clockwise or counterclockwise. And then later you have this bar where you do this or this or this. It's your choice. So there's this kind of performance indeterminacy that creeps in where there's where the performers, no two performances will be the same, and then the performers are in charge of the actual sort of surface of some of these things. There's a number of different sort of strategies. This is one in which, a measure in which all the players, they're equipped with spinners that look like this, and then they spin the spinners in unison on a certain downbeat, and that tells them which pitch to play on the next measure, and then they play the opposite quadrant two measures later. And the conductor also has a spinner of loud and quiet, and so either you'll go loud and quiet or quiet then loud in those two bars. And then this is one in which this bar, measure 34, is to be repeated X plus one times, where X is the number of times it takes three or more players to stand up and protest. So there's definitely a kind of a social project that has a consequence in terms of what we hear. Esto is a score I composed when I was living in Copenhagen. I took the subway system metro map and renamed all the stations to abstract musical provocations, and the players are synchronized with stopwatches, and these are the timetables, which are notated in minutes past the hours. So this is another kind of notational technology, and this is one of a kind of bricolage or adaptation, transformation of a sort of a found object. I think we could say the same with this project, the wristwatch pieces. Wristwatch Geology was the first of them. This is the score you're looking at, or copies of the score. I had a wristwatch manufacturer. It's a regular timepiece, but I had the manufacturer reproduce these, my own design on the face, and the players are equipped with these, and they follow the second hand, and as the second hand passes over various glyphs, they respond accordingly. This is a piece actually for players tapping and rubbing stones together. And I wanted to highlight the fact that the stone tools are a prehistoric tool. So if we've had a moment in the Middle Ages and then in the Renaissance, a tip of the hat to the prehistoric era. And I also mentioned that if we think about instruments and authentic instruments and period performance kinds of fetishes and so forth, I once had a performance at Stockholm New Music in Sweden, and I asked for 10 players who would each bring a pair of stones to play, and they gave me 10 PhDs from the Swedish Geological Institute who had like these special rocks and minerals that were cataloged from the collection. They were very excited. So I felt like That was a kind of like weirdly authentic performance of sorts. There was an opera, and the singers follow the international phonetic alphabet, which are on the wristwatch. Another one, and here's another example from wristwatch Meridian. And then finally, wristwatch Rabbit Hole is the most recent wristwatch piece. And some of these pieces invite players to determine what the pictographs mean. More on that now, because this takes us to Medium, which is the first piece in which all of my conventional kinds of notations fell away, and I was left exclusively with this kind of pictographic notation. So let me slide the pages of Medium by to the left. So this is that was page 1 and 2. This is now 2 and 3, and so forth. So you get a sense of what's happened here. This score comes with elaborate sets of instructions about how the players should relate to one another and so forth, but it says absolutely nothing. It refuses to say anything about how these symbols are to be interpreted. So it's up for every player to determine what visual information, what kind of data, how it corresponds to musical actions and sonic consequences. And in many respects, this is different than most tools are very goal-oriented. They have a certain goal in mind, and they're designed, I think, to achieve that. This is a sort of a looser goal, in a sense. This is a kind of a tool that's a provocation to see what happens in many respects. This sort of line of reasoning culminated in the Metaphysics of Notation, which was a commission from the Cantor Arts Center for ostensibly a work of visual art. It was a 72-foot long score divided into 12 6-foot wide by 10-inch tall panels of pictographic notation. It took me about a year to draw. And by the way, I have no background, formal background, or any training in visual art. This is all the consequence of preparing all those scores over many, many years that I've have a certain kind of penmanship, and I've learned how to use French curves and straight edges and drafting templates and things like that. And anyway, it was experienced around the balcony of the Cantor Art Center. Here's a sense of one of the panels, and here's another. So you can see there are these various panels. They're installed and they're experienced as visual art except all week long, except on Fridays from noon till 1, when various musical realizations occurred. There were some 45 performances by soloists and ensembles from around the world who came and realized metaphysics in sound. So again, a kind of a loose project where I'm eliciting, the goal is to elicit a response. I'll take you to, there were some hanging mobiles of score, burnt score fragments as well. And I want to show you maybe a little bit of a close-up of one of the, so here's a few panels. It's really fussy and assiduous, and I guess one of the things that I think is characteristic, and let's zoom in on this little bit here. One of the things that's characteristic, a lot of these kind of harebrained schemes I have these ideas, and they're, and it's almost a kind of self, a preemptive self-defense kind of mechanism that I have, which is like I spend a long time working meticulously on the details of these things. Like, I don't know if aphasia looked hard to you or looked like I had practiced a lot. I'm hoping it did because I did. I spent like a long, it was really hard. And my idea in all these pieces is that like the audience is gonna say, presumably, that was like a really stupid idea. I don't know why anyone would want to make a piece of music like that. But it's clear he really cared about it and he was dedicated. Okay, so I'm going for that second sort of thing. And that kind of happens, I think, in this. A last piece that I'd like to share with you is the fourth movement from Straitjacket, the so-called tachinoid movement. And let me show you a little clip from this. It's for 5 players all drawing on amplified easels. It's quite quiet, so I don't know how much you'll hear. And they're drawing in unison. They're making precisely the same sound. But you'll also notice they're producing 5 different pictographic scores. So again, rhythmic unison, but different visual consequence. This is notated as like tremolando. And what you'll notice in a moment when they lean back is that they've produced a kind of coherent or at least continuous five-part picture that extends from one panel to the next. And if you were to take the last panel and put it in front of the first panel, you would notice that it loops the sort of like visual discourse loops around that way. And if you were to stack the panels one above another, they read down. And if the last panel came on top of the first, they go around that way as well. Oh, thanks. This is what the score looks like, and every successive bar as you move from left to right, that's what your picture should look like as you've completed the next strokes, and you finally end up with something that looks more or less like this. Okay, what about the hammers, asked Charo. So the hammers, let's return to those. I think that the point for me is to add more options and to make them available. Now, why is that? Well, let's talk a little bit about this continuum here of less control to more control. I think we want more control, right? Because with less control of our tools, of our technologies, presumably that's going to turn into less originality and less creativity, and we want more. So we want to be on this end of the continuum. This has always been expressed to me as a student that like you can't simply adopt some prefabricated tool. It's better to and more creative and more original to make your own tool, because the problem is tools come loaded with assumptions and goals, and either they're somehow implicit or there's some sort of cultural environment that is in, and our imagination cannot simply break away from those. And so we're left with this sort of narrow view, some sort of myopia. So what is this space that we want to be at? Well, let's imagine that all the way on the left side, the space that we don't want to be at, is some commercial keyboard, commercial available synthesizer that has a demo song button. And all you get to do is press the song button. And what it does then is it plays a song that someone else, not you, composed, and it shows off the synthesizer, it shows off all the cool sounds and the drum beats and things like that. Well, how original is it to press that button? I can concede that, I can imagine there could be a moment when the act of pressing that button is in fact an original act of creativity, but for the most part I will concede that it's like that's not especially original or creative. Okay, so we want to move away from that. So what's the next point? Well, we'd say you got to compose your own song. You can't have that song that someone else composed. You should write out your own melody, your own harmonies, your own rhythm, come up with the tempo yourself. Okay, more creative. Someone's going to upstage you and say, yeah, but you'd have more control if you didn't just compose your own song, if you actually tweak the synthesizer patch. So you don't accept that sound that the Casio company designed for you. You should really want it, you should tweak that. And then, of course, well, if you could write your own synthesizer code, that would give you more control. That would be probably open up the doors of creativity even further. Well, why don't you just write your own operating system while we're at it? I mean, Linux or, you know, some Apple OS or some IBM thing, that comes preloaded with sort of assumptions about how we're going to be creative. So you should write your own, well, no, you should build your own computer. It's really not an act of creativity unless you build your computer. Well, you should design your own microchip. And finally, what we get here is it's not an act of creativity unless you're actually digging the silicon out of the ground. So I bring this up, I mean, it's ludicrous, right? But I bring this up because I'd like to point out that maybe we don't all want to be all the way on the right end of the continuum. I think that there's a lot of spaces to be creative inside these endpoints. So these hammers. Here are some prehistoric tools, technologies, and this is what I want to end with. Stone tools, fire, clothing, shelter, the sail, and the wheel, just a few things. What did stone tools do for us? Well, they changed our diet. We were hunters and gatherers, but the hunting part with only our hands, you know, was limited. With the kind of the arrowhead and the stone-tipped spear, we could kill other kinds of animals, and our diet transformed. I think the same could be said with fire, which is like the single most important change to our nutritional options, and as well as the fact that it allows us to live not only in warm environments, but in cool ones. So there were more options available. Clothing and shelter also transformed the kind of climates we could live in. It didn't mean that we couldn't live in very comfortable climates. It just meant that we could also, we added, there was a more diversity. We could live increasingly in harsh climates. The sail gave us transportation to other kinds of places. The wheel also had transportation to give us access to diverse places. The wheel changed with the pottery wheel, the vessels that we could store things in. And of course, it diversified our energy sources, if you think of like the water wheel and so forth. So the words that I've been trying to lay into here are diversity and options. And so my feeling, my sense about all this, and again, is not so much that we should only rehabilitate old things, and it's not that we should only look towards the future, but rather maybe the idea of diversity, for at least for artists, is to have these options, that we're not employing new tools in order to achieve, what we're interested in doing with these new tools is to simply be able to achieve diverse artistic goals, aesthetic goals. So maybe that is the point of technology and art. I leave that as a question, and I thank you very much for your attention.
Fantastic. You know, we hope you'll be able to stay around just a little bit. We're looking forward to having the chance to have you ask some of your questions. I don't think I've ever seen so many new ideas in the space of one time here in the Coolidge. We've had some, of course, amazing things going on. We've presented Harry Parch's instruments with a group called New Band, and you know about those constructions. Last night we had Henry Threadgill, whose music is based on notated music, but it very much has the effect of improvisation. We've had a lot of things. Cecil Taylor, whose scores consist of a chain of essentially numbers, which is fascinating to see. A lot of thinkers like this, but this has been fantastic. So would you guys like to come up and sit down? We don't want to lose a moment of this, and we'll pass around a microphone so that you can people can ask you questions. Great. You know, please. I was thinking about Mark, your comment. I've read about, you said when you perform, you want people to see, after you perform, you want people to say, "What the heck was that? And how can I get more of it?" And that's exactly what I thought. And I was thinking too about your comments about constructing your life through art and building a life. And this is really for both of you. And you were talking about fearlessness. Can you just start us off by talking about how, you got any advice for people? You've talked about universal music making and how we can encourage this. I found it very moving to see the globe, the people performing all over the world on your app and so forth. Do you have any advice for those of us who are just sort of out here in the audience about fearlessness?
I think our colleague and the director of Karma is quoted saying, "Well, if we knew what we're doing, it wouldn't be research." And so I have taken that, I think, perhaps more seriously than maybe I ought to, but I really hold that every day in the morning. I think, well, I don't really know what I'm doing, really, but I love what it is that I do, and you know what? I think that might in some sphere might be actually considered somewhere to be doing research.
For me, fearlessness only is sensible and is the consequence of some other preconditions. And so the main one for me is curiosity. And then possibly related to curiosity is boredom. And so for me, like, I can't compose a piece or make something unless I'm like extremely obsessed with some idea. Obsession, or almost to the point of like some sort of fetishistic resolve, is required before I can do anything meaningful. I mean, it's impossible to create unless I have that art. Fortunately, I have I'm not run out of like curiosity, so I'm like abundantly curious about all sorts of things. But it has to sort of be aroused into this state, and then the opposite side of that is the boredom. So I have like a dissatisfaction with lots of things, and so that provokes the question, what if, ellipses, question mark. And so like all of my pieces are basically responses to the question, how come there isn't a thing like this? What if we did this, and so forth? And then if the curiosity is there, then the fearlessness is really not, it doesn't feel like fearlessness. It just feels like assuaging an obsession. That's my perspective on it. Yeah.
That's wonderful. And I also wanted to ask a couple questions about you. You guys are eminently suited to answer this. In a minute, I'd like to ask your question about Stanford and what it's like to operate there. But people read a lot about the decline in attention spans, and you know, you talk a lot about you hear a lot about research that's being done about, they say in 2000 people had an attention span of 12 seconds, and now it's down to, I mean, all this stuff. That's just
wait,
so
what
much
did you
research.
Just say?
Yeah.
I couldn't help it.
So in terms of that, what's your perspective in a world when we have multiple sources, multitasking, simultaneity of multimedia going on, consuming it, and so forth? What is your perspective on art forms, and what do you think will happen to music as we move forward?
Your question really wasn't broad enough or profound enough. I was hoping for some, just the future of everything. No, it's an important question. I think with the attention span, I'll just mention something about attention. It worries me. It worries me for myself, because I feel like my attention span in some ways is narrowing. Although I do think that there is I don't demonstrate this, unfortunately, but I think there's a real virtue of concision. Right, so I think that's a really nice thing, and but in some of my pieces, I've been really interested in exploring aphoristic forms, and I don't feel that it's pandering, but maybe it's in response to my own shortened attention span. I worry about my students, I worry about it as a parent, but on the other hand, I think that most of these things that we lament and we regret are kind of like, they tend up being lateral moves. That's just the new reality. That's who we are as humans. That's who we are in our culture, and I think that you can do really great things within that space. Again, with my sort of like thesis about the inclusion and accretion of things, I would like to have a long attention span, and I would like to have attend to things which do not necessitate longer attention spans.
Mm-hmm. Any thoughts?
I don't know what's going to happen to the future of music, but I think I resonate with what Mark is saying, is that I think this. It's whether it's good or bad, I think it's just happened to be the direction we're headed in. And it's just one of these things that I think technology in its various forms is changing, has changed for the course of human history. Something comes along and we live our lives a little bit, or maybe a lot differently. And there's this trend. And at the same time, I think going back to the first question, I think it is absolutely great. And I think it's going to continue to happen, that people will continue to obsess, to take their interests to unhealthy extremes, to drive them to do something to create. I think in some ways, like kind of this shortening of attention span, at the same time, maybe brought on by just the fact that we have so much contention for our every moment of attention that we actually have. Mm-hmm. In some ways, going along with that is some potential democratization of or redemocratization of how we're actually making art, making music. That goes for how music is produced now. Mm-hmm. That goes for how video and writing, creative writing, as you might say, even though I think that's kind of redundant to say creative writing, but you know what I mean? Like all the stuff is, there's more tools at the same time for people to get their individual voices out there, and it's less about, and I think that's actually one of the very things that's actually competing for our attention, and it's not the only thing, but looking at that, I feel like there must be some good in that. Everything comes to the two sides, I suppose.
Yeah, I mean, all of these things can be used for good and evil. Like, the pencil is a technology, and in the hands of, like, somebody who's extraordinary, it can be, or not just good and evil, but, like, excellence or mundanity or something. You know what I mean? So the point is somebody could use a pencil in extraordinary ways or in very mundane and maybe inconsequential ways. And that's the same with an oboe reed and the same with a microprocessor. So there's this tendency to lump ourselves into, the future is great and everything new represents progress and that's moral in and of itself, like this technicism sort of outlook that, where technology is going to allow us to solve all of our problems and it's going to obviate God and all sorts of other things. And we're going to cure mortality, for example. I mean, people are actually, talking about this seriously. So there's that kind of side, which is like grossly optimistic and off-putting to me a little bit. And then there's the other side, which is like nostalgia for its own sake, which is like really retarded in the true sense of the word, right? I mean, it seems really ridiculous. So you have, for example, so my own stance on this is that I would like to live in a world in which acoustic instruments are heard acoustically and communally, that an audience gathers together in a community and experiences acoustic instruments. I would also like to live in a space where audiences gather together communally and they listen to music that comes through loudspeakers. And I'd also like to live in a world in which it's an option to hear music privately, individually, through, say, headphones. Mm-hmm. So the parallel is, I think there were all these rants about concerns when, like, books were widely available. And it's like, I'd like to live in a world where, like, oration of prose and poetry exists, and, like, you can go see a play or something like that. But I'd also like to be able to read the play and be in my own private world. And, so I think that there's that kind of future shock where we have all these things, new tools, and we can jump out and be alarmed and concerned by things. But I think ultimately it's a benefit to simply add and have more tools available to us.
Mm-hmm. One of the things that struck us all so much probably about your performances and talks is that you bring the technology into the past and you bring forward the past universality of our experience of music into the future. And I was thinking about those giant Welsh choruses where people sing communally, and they say there is, I don't know the scientific term for this, but they talk about the experience of singing communally in a large group like that has some physical manifestation and it does unite you. It's something like entrainment, but they've done research on this. So that's very much, those kinds of things are popping up, and I just admire you both so much for thinking these things and realizing them and doing them. I know our time is somewhat limited, so I want to throw this open to everyone. So if you have a question, Solomon has the microphone.
Hi. Yes, it's on. Hi, I'm Artie. To the point that you were talking about fearlessness, you were talking about fearlessness and you're talking about other things. What advice would you give to people who work in places where that fearlessness isn't appreciated, places where it's hard to build an environment where you can ask what if openly? How do you go about building that if you've had experience building that? Because obviously it's difficult places, especially a lot of places in DC. How do you do that?
That's a great question. Do you have some thoughts on that? Well, I think that, I'm going to, like, a worn-out record, and that's a vinyl one, by the way. The way I see it is, I ran a salon series when I was a graduate student in my living room when I was a graduate student at University of California, San Diego.
It's like my observation was I have a couch, and I happen to be blessed to have a piano. And more important, I know really cool, interesting people. And these were like poets and filmmakers and all, and musicologists and stuff. And it was a potluck dinner thing, and people would, and there would be a program, there'd be some music, and somebody would give a formal paper, and somebody would lead a discussion. I think people would show their work. It was just really a kind of a cool thing. The secret, now it's not so secret, now I'm announcing it. The secret title in my mind for that Salon series was Dry Run for the Cultural Apocalypse, which was like, which was about a certain kind of concern that I had as a graduate student about to leave the nurturing space of school and enter a world where my interest didn't match with any kind of commercial viability. And so, I mean, this is a very cavalier thing to hear from, and maybe irrelevant to hear from a professor, because I make my living, I get money from being a professor. And fortunately, Stanford not only indulges but necessitates a kind of experimental vector in my art. But of course, it's not commercially viable. I couldn't make a living, I don't think, doing the kinds of things I do. So I'm sorry for that digression, but that was important context for this response. So back to the Salon series. So my observation with this fear and this concern, this anxiety, was that okay, if Lincoln Center calls, or like the Berlin Philharmonic wants to do like a week-long retrospective of my works, I'm gonna take that phone call, okay? But on the other hand, it seems ridiculous to be totally creatively impotent and just completely, not realizing some sort of artistic interest and potential while I'm waiting for that phone call, which, by the way, still has not come, and I don't anticipate it ever will. So in the meantime, it's like, oh, I know some interesting people, and like, oh, there here are some stones that I can tap together and stuff. So this is a long précis to saying that, like, why worry about the audience? Why have an audience? Just do your thing. And then, like, you might find, like, oh, you know one other person who's interested, and you can, like, actually talk about it. That one other person that's a good thing. You can have like one other person. But then like the one to 1 million is actually not like a million. A million isn't a million better than one. It's like a little better than one. This is my personal, right? So yeah, it's totally great that you build like a space, and I'm all for many of my dear friends who are interested in creating civic awareness and all sorts of cultural infrastructure for cities and countries and exchanges internationally, and I'm totally blessed by having that available to me. But I think we can't wait around for that as artists. You have to just figure out what the resources are at hand and do something with them. I didn't like that answer, did you? It was like, you wanted more of a special, like, magic panacea, like special elixir. I don't know.
I think I agree.
I learned how to do computer music, for example, because I was teaching at Mississippi State University before I taught at Stanford. And it was an environment where I didn't have like the kind of musicians and ensembles that I was accustomed to working with, who had this certain kind of refined dedication to a certain kind of, I guess we'll just call it like the new complexity sort of like genre that I was interested in pursuing in some measure. And so then the computer music thing, I like learned how to use Pro Tools, and I started making remixes of things and so forth. It was a lonely undertaking, but I could remain creatively viable. So you can figure out how big of an audience do you really need? It's just more about like finding your people and just making sure you get out there and have conversations, going and listening to other people, conversing with them, moving around geographically, but also moving around just culturally in a particular space.
Yeah, I think you just keep doing your thing. let the haters hate.
George Lewis once said something to me that was totally extraordinary. He doesn't remember this. This is like so important to me, but he claims that he didn't say it, but maybe I dreamt that George said this. He basically, so to paraphrase this thing that I remember, he said, he was like, some people work for like year in and year out, decade in and decade out, on their own weird, idiosyncratic, personal vision of something, and they get like really good at it, and they really work on it, and they produce some sort of thing that represents that. And then they die, and no one's heard of them. And then centuries pass, and no one discovers their work, and it's lost for all eternity. He said, but that's a life that's worth living, a life through art that's worth living. And then he said, some people work year in and year out, decade in and decade out, never known. They don't make any money from their, they're not celebrated during their lifetime. But centuries later, someone discovers this stuff and they say, holy cow, look at this. This person was really onto something. They really explored this stuff and now we have the benefit of seeing all the, he said, that's a life that's worth living. Some people work really hard, decade, and in the twilight years, at the very end, then Lincoln Center calls and they have their Pulitzer Prize and their Nobel or what, you know, whatever, and their MacArthur is probably, you know. And so there's this whole celebration of them, and that's exciting, and that's a life that's worth living. And he said, and a very few people work really hard, and during like the middle of their life, they actually have like this career, and they're professionally celebrated, and so forth. And he's, you know, very few of the group, you know, he said, that's a life that's worth living, but you're not eligible for any of these outcomes unless you have this thing that you're working on, and you're working on, and you're working, you're really dedicated to. And that was like, that was bracing for me. That's a great answer.
I wanted to thank you guys for a really interesting, thought-provoking, mind-expanding presentations today and performances. It was really, really fantastic. Understanding that maybe the Berlin Philharmonic hasn't called and the Lincoln whatever hasn't called, have any of the modern commercial bands contacted you guys? It seems like there's more and more electronic music every year, and that's making it commercially.
You probably are. I mean, you've met T-Pain.
I think that we do see. I personally haven't had like a haven't had a lot of calls to go perform, but had a lot of calls to go talk about what it is that I'm doing, which I'm still trying to figure out what that is exactly. But it was nice to meet T-Pain at some point. But I think maybe the ways to get our, like, for example, to get what I consider to be my art out there is just different now. Like, I mean, I think about the software that I put out there, well, most of which is open source and freely available. And then, of course, the Smule apps, they try to get some money from you. But either way, it's I see that as kind of stuff that makes me feel good, and in some ways the same way as if I stepped on stage and did more of a traditional performance. I think to me as a performing artist, that type of a thing has been satisfying, and I'll leave it at that for now.
I wrote a pop song this summer for the first time, but it's not just that, like, okay, I came out with a pop song. I worked with some famous pop songwriters in the way that pop songs are being written now. And of course, they're from, if you know anything about pop songs, they're from Sweden. So that's, you know, it's like, these are people who work with Max Martin and Red One and so forth. And so that was a really interesting experience that was a whole culture and a different, so that, if that song gets, we're in the process of shopping it now. If it actually gets picked up by somebody who's famous and is produced, that will be I will be known farther for that than anything else, and it will be like the least represented in the pie graph of the things that I do. It'd be this little kind of narrow thing. But that said, like, I also gave this TED talk, and then like 500,000 people have seen it, and so I've actually been stopped in Trafalgar Square by an Argentinian bicyclist on the streets of Amsterdam, and somebody who got off a plane from Germany. And it's just like weird, so that's like a weird thing where I wasn't talking about pop music, I was talking about like my weird stuff that I refer to as uncompromising and unmarketable experimental music. So there are channels now through, you know, where people can hear things.
I guess I'd like to ask both of you, to what extent you think that the purpose of art is about communication? Because the first scenario you gave, Mark, about somebody who does something idiosyncratic for their whole life, but they're never discovered, that's a life worth living, that's a life well spent. But I wonder to what extent you think that art is about communication, and that's the purpose of art. I'd like to ask both of you that question.
I think it's a great purpose of art. I just don't think it's the lone purpose, or expressed a different way. I think there's a lot of ways of communicating. I'm an atheist, but I imagine that some people feel that they're communicating with a power or a spirit that is otherworldly, okay? And so we could judge that and say that there's no communication there. I wouldn't judge that except for myself. That's kind of an extreme, a certain kind of example, but then you could imagine the person, you could communicate to an imagined audience, and I think that's in other words, there's a broader notion of communication that can include a lot of different modalities. I would invert that in some ways in saying, like, okay, so let's imagine we have a big audience. Did they actually apprehend what I was trying to communicate? So just because there's lots of people in the room, it doesn't mean that anything has been received that is remotely like, if we're imagining some like intention in the communication and that it's been absorbed or understood. I don't know. What do you think?
I suppose like for a while, especially in high school when I started first just working with music and just playing music and writing some music, I think the audience was for myself, and I felt like it was a way to communicate, but it was just a very auto, like a loop back. But I thought that was meaningful, and in some ways, maybe, you know, so I was saying maybe this, if people are making art or creating in some level, and they're enriching themselves through it, and they're realizing maybe it's a different take on communication that we're just kind of doing it with ourselves. And in some ways, that maybe even positions then some outward communication as well. But I do think art is art, and I think as long as it's made, it's already communicated in some sense. And I guess it's a function of how, well, it's a matter of how wide you want that to go.
Another question? You know, I wanted to ask one more question about Stanford before we end, and that is a lot of places have similar sort of organizations to Karma and so forth, and I was wondering if there's any particular organizing force or ethos there or something like that. I know Todd Machover's Media Lab has taken a direction recently towards maybe a therapeutic angle on music with his conceptions for helping people with Alzheimer's and disabled people, and it's rather fascinating. And I look at the incredible outpouring of what's going on at Stanford, and I see just so much. Is there anything you'd like to talk about the program before we end? Any particular passions out there?
Maybe I'll just say, like, I think Karma is a wonderful place because it's we kind of don't have, as far as I know, like a very clear overarching mission.
That's what I look. Yeah, that's what it looked like. But you allowed so many flourishings.
And I think it's an environment that's kind of engineered for one thing, and that's kind of this serendipity. Mm-hmm. Of you're like increase the chances of serendipity happening, and in some sense, like as far as research is concerned, it's like the. To me, it's like the best case of like having the freedom to tinker. And I think that is what leads to, I think what Mark was maybe saying at the beginning, also towards what, you
remarkable
know,
just,
that you can work on something, work something deeply, mm-hmm. and you work on it out of just curiosity that you, but then you mm-hmm. don't, you take it, you stay the course yeah. on it. So I think in some ways that's a deep appreciation I feel for Karma, and that's environment that we are. Mm-hmm. I think we find ourselves in.
You know, it slowly morphs and it transforms over time. At any given time, you'll have some people who are really interested in like just writing lots of code, and then you'll have all these people who are like really interested in improvisation, and then there'll be like low latency internet streaming and communication, and then you'll have like this big neuroscience thing that will be going on, and everyone has to show their MRI pictures and the colors of the brain lighting up in different places, and then you'll have like these things where there's like, you know, you know, all sorts of timbral, like synthesis and digital signal processing. The point is there's all these different sort of psychoacoustics and so forth, these different projects that keep morphing and blending and overlapping. But I think that the two things that I've noticed that have been really great is that Chris Chafe has been really concerned, he's one of the directors of Carmen, he's been really concerned about this thing that he first expressed to me as a kind of a pendulum that's essentially from the sort of engineering, math, physics side to the performance, the arts performance, arts practitioner side. And any time that it swings one way too far or the other, he kind of wants to gently, and not with a strong overcorrection, but sort of make sure that in an almost affirmative action way, we kind of bring back and support the other side to kind of harmonize that. And I think he's done that really well. And then the second principle that he's done really well is that it's a kind of wonderful chaos there. It's so not top down. It's just this grassroots thing. You come and you do your thing, and there's a foosball table, and everyone plays foosball, and then they, at 3 a.m., and then they're talking about it. It's got to be, like, for me, the most famous organization in the world that is also, it seems like, often totally, not disorganized, because that's a pejorative word, but, like, non-organized.
A-organized.
Well, certainly that freedom and inspiration has come through in everything that you did. We really cannot thank you warmly enough for this fantastic presentation today. Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for having us.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.